Again, good afternoon. My name is Iwona Reichardt. I am a deputy editor-in-chief of a bi-monthly magazine called New Eastern Europe. We are published in Poland, but distributed worldwide. And we focus, as the name suggests, on the region that is east to Poland predominantly, but also the region that the countries that were before under a Soviet influence, the so-called communist bloc. I have an honor to moderate this distinguished panel of experts who came to us from very far away. Bruno came from Beijing. I'm from Krakow. Marcel arrived from Paris, and Anton came from Vienna, I assume. I think it's a unique. I know in Warsaw you are spoiled with wonderful panels, but I am convinced that this is a unique opportunity to have such diverse group of people meet here and talk about the Russian propaganda. Let me now introduce to you briefly our panelists. To my left is Marcel van Herpen, a director of the Cicero Foundation in Paris, an expert on security issues and author of three books on Russia, including the 2015 book on the propaganda, on Putin's propaganda machine. We have reviewed this book in our magazine, and according to the reviewer, it's a must read for anybody who is interested in software power, misinformation, disinformation, and Russia's usage of new information technologies and new information tools. To my right is Bruno Maçaes, former political scientist, Portuguese citizen of Portugal, former Secretary of State for European Affairs for the Portuguese government. Currently, Bruno is traveling throughout the post-Soviet space, collecting data and material and researching for his forthcoming book. From what I understand, the title is
New
the
Eurasian Supercontinent.
New Eurasian Supercontinent. And next to Bruno is Anton Shekhovtsov. In a dual role, yes, as a fellow, visiting fellow from the Institute for Human Science in Vienna and the Legatum Institute in London. Anton focuses on predominantly on illiberal tendencies in Europe, the extreme right. He is the editor of a of the journal Explorations of the Far Right, and a member of the editorial board of the e-journal Fascism Journal of Comparative Fascist Studies. So as you see, we have a very unique panel of experts. I believe that this the exchange of our thoughts will enable us to have a multi-dimensional understanding or picture of the ways and means of Russian propaganda. And the question is, why are we talking right now about Russian propaganda when here in Warsaw we will be hosting quite soon another huge event, namely the NATO summit, and the whole focus right now is on military power, yes, and military might. But I'm sure I don't need to convince you here, and especially those of you who work with in the field of social sciences and media and deal with the power of information, that the power and the might of ideas can be just as strong and as effective as the military might. Tomorrow, another reason that we are talking about propaganda and the value of information here in Warsaw is tomorrow in Poland we are celebrating another anniversary of our partially free elections that took place on the 4th of June in 1989. And those of you who remember communism and either grew up under communism or were adults, remember the power of information that was coming from the West and how it shaped our thinking and actually our will for freedom. And I can assure you that I was one of those who was reading or maybe sometimes even looking, because not always understanding, the Western press, watching the Western movies that I also sometimes didn't even understand. But the attraction of these values that was coming from these messages was the dream that actually made us, I think, in 1999, make the choice that we made here in Poland. That is why our panel will not try to answer the question if Russian propaganda is effective. I would like us to move one step forward and try to understand why is it effective. And I would like to draw from the experiences and the knowledge of our distinguished panelists, who will try to explain it to us why, even in such societies as the French society or the Austrians, which with deeply rooted democratic cultures, these propaganda messages that seem sometimes so obvious to us, at least researchers, get rooted, get the right audience, and are later repeated and also enter the mainstream. I will start with Marcel.
Thank you. Yes, we are speaking this afternoon about disinformation and propaganda war. I will speak especially about France and a bit about the referendum in the Netherlands about Ukraine. And if we talk about information war, we only most of the time think about the press, RT, the Russian TV channel, the channel. But if you look at how this information war is conducted by Russia, it is clear that it is a multifaceted and very rich approach, which not only has to do with the press, but also with all the mediums. If you look to the information war as conducted by Russia, then we see that RT, Russia Today, as it was called before, played a very important role. It's watched at the moment by about 700 million people worldwide. And if you are in a television, you are in a hotel room in Washington or in Paris, or, well, not here, I didn't try, but maybe also, you can watch RT. RT, this year, it has started also to with programs in French and in German, because France and Germany are very important countries for Moscow. But there's another thing, what's interesting, is in a program called Russia Beyond the Headlines. And Russia Beyond the Headlines is a project led by Rossiyskaya Gazeta, the official Russian state paper, in which the laws are written and official messages. And this paper organizes supplements that are added to Western quality papers, and not the least, in France, it is Le Figaro. And every month there is an edition, a special edition in French. It's called La Russie d'aujourd'hui, Russia Today, also. And this is a very interesting small paper, which is paid for by the Kremlin. You can read about Russian cuisine, tourism, very nice pictures in it, and a little bit of politics. But these politics are not what you think it is. It is not Russian propaganda. It is very intelligent. You can read, for instance, an interview with Ludmila Ulitskaya, a Russian writer who said, I am corresponding with Khodorkovsky, who was then in jail, and he is a brilliant man. And you can read also that the manifestations in Russia in 2012 against Putin made the Russian political life more lively. So what is happening here is that the Russian messages to the Western public are making use of very interesting sociological theories. The first theory is the theory of sociologist Festinger of cognitive dissonance. That means you you have to adapt your message to the public. And if you're talking to a Western public, you should not use old Soviet propaganda. No, your public is educated, is liberal, so you have to package your news in a liberal Western style. The second theory is used is the two-step flow of communication of a sociologist, Lazarsfeld, because these small papers every month are you can find them in Western quality papers. It's the Washington Post, it's the New York Times, the Süddeutsche Zeitung, it's Repubblica in Italy, El País in Spain, etc., etc. Le Monde in France has not yet been asked, I think, or maybe they have refused, but I'm not sure. But anyway, this is a very interesting propaganda, because the propaganda is between the lines. Another interesting project in France was, if you can buy, well, advertisement space in French papers or in international papers, why should you not buy a paper? Start yourself a paper. So that's what was done by a Russian oligarch, Sergei Pugachev, who bought in 2009 a French paper, François. François was one of the biggest French papers after the war, but it went down and down and down and down, and at the end it had only 35,000 subscribers. The idea was to make of François a French Bild-Zeitung of 1 million or 2 million copies. The son of Pugachev was in charge, Alexander Pugachev, who was openly an admirer of the French Front National and wanted to make this paper in support of the Front National. The problem was this project didn't work, and it had to be cancelled in the end of 2011 after having lost 80 million euros. So you see that the information war is done with television, RT. RT is for the big mass of people, the quality papers, and you try to buy a paper. Well, in the UK, you had also an Alexander Lebedev who has bought a paper, but he is a little bit different position because he is the co-owner of Novaya Gazeta together with Gorbachev. The information war is not only fought by television, papers and so on, but also by institutions. If you look in France, there has been made an institute. It's called the Institut de la Démocratie et de la Coopération, so the Institute of Democracy and Cooperation. It's led by Natalia Narodnitskaya, who is a member, a former Duma member of Rodina, the ultra-nationalist party of Rogozin. And she is organizing in Paris seminars with Eurosceptic themes, that Euro is bad. One time there was a general, Alex Vladimirov, who has said in 2007 that within 10 to 15 years there would be a war between USA and Russia, and so on and so on. Then we have Ruski Mir, a Russian World, the organization, and Rassotrudnicheство, an aid agency. These two organizations organize Russian centers at universities. This is a very interesting thing because they are copying a Chinese initiative who do the same, and it has a lot of criticism it had raised in the United States, and universities have refused this type of Russian center, because if you have a Russian center at the university, it's paid for by the Kremlin. What to do with your free academic research and academic freedom of speech, because some subjects are not done. So this is a means to influence universities. In France, you have further also, let's say, in dialogue franco-russe. This is a an, an, an an organization by the big business in France to do business with Russia. The director is Desmarais. He's the CEO of Total. His co-director is Yakunin, the man of the Russian railways. It's interesting that Total, who has big interests in Russia, they are giving money to IFRI. IFRI is a French international institute that gets about 28% of its budget from the French state, but it's not enough, so they need money. Total pays totally three places in the Russian center of IFRI. It's very interesting that if you look what these people then say, one of them, Tatiana Kostoyeva-Jean, after the Crimea was annexed, they said, well, I don't talk about sanctions. I'm not for and I'm not against. I want to do my research. Another one, who is the director, Thomas Gomard, who wrote an eulogy for Putin on the Valdai Center, Valdai Club website for the 60th birthday of Putin. So you see that it's not only about press, it's also influence on economic leaders, it's even influence at universities and influence at Western NGOs and think tanks. And I think that is a real problem. But then we have the political parties. You have, all of you, you have heard about the Front National. In 2014, one of their members, Chauprade, who is the advisor of Marine Le Pen, he was an observer in the referendum in the Crimea. And immediately there was also, afterwards, in 2014, this question of a loan given by the first Czech-Russian bank of 9 million euros, and this year there is a demand for a loan of 27 million euros for the presidential elections. So we see that there is a lot of influence going on in France, and the last point I want to give here is the Russian Orthodox Church. The Russian Orthodox Church is very interesting. It was always a national church. Under Putin, it is going global. It's becoming a global church with global pretensions. And after in 2007, there was a merger with the Russian Orthodox Church outside Russia, in America, and that means that 323 parishes of the Russian Orthodox Church outside Russia, which was a church made by immigrants after the Bolshevik Revolution, came back with Moscow. They have 323 parishes. The bishops are being appointed by Moscow, by the Patriarch. And this church, this Orthodox Church outside Russia, had 1 million believers in 30 countries. So it's a good start for Putin to start a real global church. And he is busy now to reclaim church properties abroad, in Paris, in Nice, in Cannes, Biarritz, and many believers who didn't want to come back in Moscow have started juridical cases against this. So you see, if we talk about this information war, it is a global war, and it's something that is not only about RT, the television, it's much more. I hope I didn't speak too long.
And Anton, you focus in your research on the illiberal tendencies throughout Europe. We also witnessed the recent presidential elections in Austria. Could you elaborate on how do you see the work of Russian propaganda in this regard?
Yeah, thank you. And I think I will come to the Austrian case bit later, but I just want to give you sort of a general picture on the relations between Russia and the Western far right. I'm finishing a book on this subject, and hopefully it will be published still this year, but something that I have, some of the insights that I have, I can share with you. Talking about Russia and the Western far right, or European far right, sometimes we make a mistake, and especially journalists very, very often make a mistake by saying just Russia without differentiating between various actors that are involved in this cooperation. If we don't take the Cold War history, or the history after the Second World War, and the limited but still viable cooperation between Soviet Russia or the Soviet Union and various far-right groups. During the 90s, or at least the current developments within the current cooperation is quite a new phenomenon. And I will focus on three particular periods of time, which I find especially important. But before I talk about 2004, which I find one of the dates that provides good information, I can say that since the 90s, when after the collapse of the Soviet Union, there was a limited cooperation between various Western and European right-wing extremists and Russian right-wing extremists. These are first and foremost Vladimir Zhirinovsky of the misleadingly named Liberal Democratic Party of Russia. This is Alexander Dugin, the ideologue of neo-Eurasianism. And this is also Sergei Glazyev, who's now advisor to Putin on the foreign policy in the Commonwealth of the independent states, but in the 90s he was a figure in the opposition to the regime. So 2004, if you remember, that was the year of the Orange Revolution in Ukraine, but that was also a period from 2003-2005 when three color revolutions took place in Georgia, Ukraine, and Kyrgyzstan. And that scared a lot in Moscow. These events were considered by the Russians as the West's betrayal of Russia, because the presidential term of Mr. Putin in 2004, he believed that the West accepted Russia as our bastard. They may be not entirely democratic, but they would still cooperate with Russia in terms of business and in terms of also various initiatives that the Russians were implementing in the West, like money laundering, for example, or buying political influence in the West, or sending their children to the most prestigious universities in the West, while being almost greeted, the Russians were greeted by Western leaders as an aspiring democracy, as a country in transformation, and it went on for about 4 years, but then Russia thought that all those color revolutions, those were the West's conspiracy against Russia. And the power elites that constituted around one-third of the ruling elite in Russia, and by the power elite I'm talking about former and current members of various security services, intelligence services, army, police, etc., etc., who were raised basically on anti-Western narratives during the Cold War, they started to have an upper hand and saying to the Kremlin, saying to the people close to Putin, look, the West is conspiring against us. So what happened, and here where the far-right cooperation comes in, is that they looked at how all those color revolutions happened, and they noticed the significant role of various NGOs that observed the elections and could say those elections were not fair, or they were not open enough, and they were not legitimate. And for example, Yanukovych, Mr. Yanukovych, was elected unfairly in Ukraine. Something that appeared in 2004-2005 was an alternative way of observing elections. An organization was formed around 2004, CISEMO, which stands for Commonwealth of Independent States Electoral Monitoring Organization. That was not a Kremlin's initiative, but they understood the usefulness of that organization. So what that organization would do? It would go to various elections and to observe electoral process, or to referenda, and they might even be very unfair or fraudulent, but they would say, especially if the Russian foreign policy was at stake. For example, they would observe elections where pro-Russian politicians would be elected. And depending on who was winning, they would say, if the pro-Russian politician would be winning, they would say the elections were fair. And it was the other way around. The thing is that they started to position themselves as an international monitoring organization. So they wanted to invite Europeans or Westerners to be part of those electoral monitoring missions. The problem for them was that not many Western politicians or Western observers were ready to do that thing. And they found out that members of far-right organizations were willing to do this. And this cooperation developed, and something that we saw in Crimea in March 2014, where the majority of so-called observers of the so-called referendum were representatives of the far-right organizations. But that started in 2004-2005, so it had a very long history of that particular type of cooperation. And then the monitoring organizations would go to Transnistria, to Abkhazia, to South Ossetia to do the same. So that was the beginning, 2004-2005, of one particular initiative. This is the cooperation between various Russian actors, not necessarily the Kremlin, with the electoral observation missions. The second one was connected to the war on Georgia in 2008. The Russians won the war very easily in 5 days. But they understood that their soft power was not working. They understood that, okay, they won the war, but they failed, and they understood that very well. They failed to convince the West that their war was legitimate and it was a fair play. And this is when Russia Today started to rebrand itself. Because previously they were called Russia Today, and in 2008-2009 they decided that they would call themselves RT in order to hide the Russian origin of that TV. And they also changed the perspective, because previously Russia Today was a genuinely soft power tool in order to influence public opinion in the West, which is not really bad per se, because everybody is doing this. But what they started to do, they started to add to this narrative of soft power. It's not that was they thought that the narrative Russia is good was not really working anymore. So they decided to add a bit of narrative that was about the West is bad. So this combination about Russia is good and the West is bad started to work for them, in a sense. And again, who would you invite to say, and those people should be Westerners, those people should be Europeans or Americans, who would say that the West is bad? Of course, you're skeptics. The far right, the far left, conspiracy theorists, and again, isolationists, and all those people who want the destruction of the EU. So that was a second very important initiative and a second very important aspect of the cooperation between the Russian media and the far right in the West. And then the third point, or the third period that I want to talk about, is 2011, 2012. You may remember about Sergei Magnitsky. Sergei Magnitsky was a Russian lawyer who was working for the Hermitage company, and he was tortured and he died in custody in Russia in 2009, as far as I understand. The thing is that in 2011, 2012, the West started to react, to respond to the death of Magnitsky. And that was basically the first time when Western countries introduced sanctions on a particular Russian actors, officials, who the US and the EU thought were responsible for the death of Magnitsky. So those were the first significant sanctions. And Russia reacted again very aggressively. But also 2011, 2012, that was the time of the Arab Spring. And that was the time of quite powerful protests against Putin, against the parliament, after the parliamentary elections in 2011 and after the presidential elections 2012. So the combination of these factors again contributed to the feeling of the Kremlin that the West was conspiring against Russia, that they wanted to overthrow Putin's regime. And that's when the anti-Western ideologies started to be promoted even further. So in 2004, 2005, that was the start of this return to the anti-Western narrative. But in 2011, 2012, that was almost complete. Russia, and it was quite clear from the Putin's addresses at the Valdai Club, which is a soft power tool established in 2009. That was clear from his addresses to the Federal Assembly and in many other statements, that Putin and the Kremlin were taking this anti-Western turn. And they also started to look for political allies in the West who would be sympathetic towards Russia. The problem for them was that they still wanted to cooperate with the mainstream politicians. But it turned out that Gerhard Schröder's, Nicolas Sarkozy's, and Silvio Berlusconi's were actually in shortage. There was a shortage of them. Those people who were ready to cooperate, Gerhard Schröder became one of the heads of Gazprom. Berlusconi was almost retired. Sarkozy was not in power. Hollande won in France. So they started to look for other political allies. But they were very, very cautious. It was not straightforward. And here where Austria comes in. The major party, which is on the far right in Austria, is the Freedom Party of Austria. They started various conferences that were blatantly pro-Russian already in 2008, 2009. But they were not really accepted by the establishment in Russia. Some establishment figures would cooperate with the Freedom Party of Austria, but still, no high-ranking politicians did that. The only reason why the Kremlin, I mean really high-ranking politicians, did not want to cooperate with the FPÖ, because they still wanted to cooperate with the Social Democratic Party of Austria and the Conservative Party of Austria, which is the Austrian People's Party. Because of the connections between Russian businessmen and the oligarchs to the financial system, economic system of Austria, implies that if you cooperate with the Social Democrats and the Conservatives and then start high status cooperation with their competitors, you would actually discredit yourself in the eyes of the Social Democrats and the Conservatives, and you would have problems with the investments in Austria. But nevertheless, this cooperation continued. There were several initiatives that were started together with the Rossatrudnicestvo that Marcel mentioned, and also not with the Ruski Mir, but with some other organizations. For example, those were the Russian Ball in Hofburg, the Russian Ball in Vienna, that was organized several years ago by one Russian expatriate, but those Russian balls were quite political. They would, for example, read the addresses of Sergei Aksyonov, who is an illegitimate leader or head of the of Crimea. They would also be promoting this far-right Freedom Party of Austria, and Freedom Party of Austria would sponsor the event. The Russians are apparently behind one of the very glossy magazine, which is again a magazine that promotes far-right and conspiracy theories, and is connected to the Freedom Party of Austria. So there are initiatives which I would say not of a very high status in Austria. Very few people would go to the Russian Ball in Vienna, or very few people would buy that magazine, which is called InfoDirect. But I would say that this understanding that Russia is always very cautious about building links with the far right, this is quite important, and this may explain why, for example, Marine Le Pen, who wanted to go to Russia to visit some high-ranking politicians already in 2011, was only able to do this in 2013, because the Russians waited for the outcome of the presidential elections in France in 2012, because they did not want to give so too much honor to Marine Le Pen before the elections in France, in order not to spoil relations with Hollande or Sarkozy, because they were also competing for the presidential post. But in after the 2012 and especially 2013, this cooperation with Front National was more and more active, and one of the results is the multi-million loan that was granted to Front National by one Russian bank. And this cooperation, I'm finishing probably, this cooperation, it always depends on various national contexts. But at the same time, something about propaganda that I want to say, especially with the media, when the Russian media, especially state-funded like RT or Sputnik or previously the Voice of Russia, why they engaged with the far right, because they believe in the theory, which is Andrew Wilson calls this theory an echo chamber. It means that you introduce a narrative in the media space, and this narrative may be heard by 1,000 people. Presumably 500 would believe that. But also this narrative, it travels across the media space, and no longer you understand that this particular narrative may be coming from the far right or conspiracy theorists or even Russians. It just exists in the information space or in the media space. Also, this echo chamber almost makes it useless sometimes to debunk the disinformation spread by the Russians, because, okay, 1,000 people read a particular narrative in a Russian-sponsored media resource, 5,000 believe in that, but only 100 would read that it was a disinformation, that it was not true. So still, they do cooperate with the far right as well as with the far left and various conspiracy theories, because they believe that they can influence the public opinion in the West, which is actually may not be true, because the most recent public opinion polls confirm that there are not many people actually who support Russian foreign policy. But I think that when assessing the Russian disinformation campaigns or propaganda campaigns, we should also look at how of whether people who were exposed to Russian propaganda. The question for us would be not that they might have become more pro-Russian. No, it's not happening. The question would be whether Russian propaganda influenced them in a way that they started to be less confident and less trustful towards their own governments. Because, as I said in the beginning, the narrative, which is Russia is good, is not even the main narrative. The main narrative is that the West is bad. Thank you.
And talking about the narrative, the West is bad. Bruno, you have traveled throughout the post-Soviet space recently, but you have, in your previous work experience, you worked for the Portuguese government. How do you look at this message, the West is bad, there and in your home country?
Thank you. I am not an expert on Russia disinformation as opposed to my two fellow panelists. So I will look at this with a more detached and skeptical outlook. Maybe that is why I was invited. And I will give some examples from my experience in politics. And also not so much in Portugal, where Russia is not an important question, but from Brussels and what I saw in Brussels. Now, let me make a few initial distinctions. First of all, I think we have to distinguish between propaganda, information wars, and other activities that are going on, but that are different. We all know that there's examples of blackmail against Western politicians being exerted by Russian secret services. We know there are cases of corruption. It's difficult to talk about this because, well, first of all, these are police matters, criminal activities. And so it's not something that we can easily talk about in a panel like this. Let's leave this to the police authorities. But we know this is going on, has an impact. It's different in essence, in nature, from other activities that we more properly would call information war, where you try to propagate certain ideas or a certain outlook on the world. Let me make another distinction. I think Russian propaganda, Russia disinformation, when it comes to the content of the message, its effectiveness is very doubtful, and I'll give some examples. I think its effectiveness is a lot more powerful when it comes to a certain management of feelings in Western elites and Western public opinion. The way you try to manage emotional reactions to political developments, not so much the content. I think here it's very different from Soviet propaganda, which was focused on the content. And there's a lot of literature on this difference between a propaganda that is focused on the content and a propaganda that is interested in the effect that it produces. I think Marcel has written on this, and there's a number of recent books trying to look at a sort of postmodern propaganda because it's no longer interested in facts as much as in creating certain emotional maps and emotional reactions. Let me give you one example of this from my experience in politics. There was a rather perplexing development after Crimea. If you go back, I think maybe some historians will do this or some journalists, it would be an interesting story to tell. If you go back to the official statements from, especially from the Foreign Affairs Council, for about a year, the Foreign Affairs Council never talked about Russian presence in Eastern Ukraine, never. I remember one case, I sometimes went to the Foreign Affairs Council. One time I decided to make a suggestion to alter the text and to add Russian-backed rebels in eastern Crimea. So it was not even Russian troops. It was the notion that these rebels were not independent from Russia. They were backed by Russia, which now seems, you know, the softest approach that you could take to what was happening there, because we now know there were regular Russian troops in the tens of thousands present and still are. This suggestion that I made was shot down, especially by one foreign minister, is no longer foreign minister at the time. But others in general agreed that this was harsh language and that we didn't need it. Now, was this because, as I've read in some papers, because Russian propaganda had succeeded in convincing foreign ministries across Europe that it was not present in eastern Ukraine? No. Those same foreign ministers that said in the meeting that they did not agree with the sentence that I wanted to add were the first to recognize after the meeting, talking in the bar, that Russian troops were present in eastern Ukraine. They knew that. Everyone knew that. No. I mean, journalists knew that. Of course, foreign ministers have access to classified information, knew that. So the question is not about the content. And the dangers don't have to do so much with the content. It really is silly to suggest that Russian propaganda had succeeded in convincing us that they were not in Ukraine. What perhaps they had succeeded to some extent, because some of these things are not just the product of Russian propaganda, they are the product of other forces, historical forces, political forces. But what they had to some extent succeeded in doing was managing reactions by Western politicians, creating a certain emotional landscape where it was important not to be too aggressive. It was important for Western politicians to separate themselves from American politicians, always more ready for confrontation. It was important for European politicians to give dialogue an opportunity early on. It was important for European politicians to try to be balanced between Ukraine and Russia, and a number of other concerns which were somehow important and which were dictating the reaction and a certain reluctance to be too confrontational early on. If this is true, then things like intimidation are part of propaganda. I think Russia has been very successful. I think Russia has been completely incapable of convincing the West of facts, of a number of facts, or influencing the content of the message. I really don't think so. I don't think there are facts in the public discussion that are introduced by Russian propaganda. But I do think they have been very successful when it comes to intimidation. Perhaps the European Union is already sort of inclined towards dialogue, inclined towards consensus politics, not inclined towards confrontation. And sometimes Russia, in a very surgical and very skillful way, will send messages of confrontation, of open confrontation, will send messages that even create the conviction among policymakers that perhaps the Russian leadership is not entirely stable. From an emotional point of view, I go back to Machiavelli. This is an important thing to do: convince your opponent that perhaps you're a little bit mad. Donald Trump has been making this suggestion and being criticized for it. Honestly, here I have to agree with Donald Trump. It goes back to the basic principles of politics in international politics, that uncertainty is important, creating uncertainty on the other side. Russia has been doing this very well, and so European politicians are not inclined towards confrontation. Here, these surgically introduced messages, sometimes about nuclear confrontation, every 2 or 3 months, not an official in Moscow, but sometimes, most often the Prime Minister, Medvedev, has been picked to do this. He will talk about nuclear war. And this has an effect. And I think here propaganda has been very effective. When it comes to the facts, I really don't see it. Everyone knew about the presence in eastern Ukraine. This was never disguised. This was never, Russia was never able to disguise that fact. I think it was more of an emotional process. By the way, then at some point, the texts, I mean, journalists and historians can go back and analyze this. At some point, the texts, overnight, I noticed this, I remember talking to my office, to my staff, that overnight the text started to talk about Russian presence in eastern Ukraine. And then it was, you know, it was from one extreme to the other. Until this particular day, you didn't even talk about influence Russian influence in Eastern Ukraine, and then overnight it became Russian military presence in Eastern Ukraine. So there's a certain emotional factors that are present here, not just politicians, but bureaucrats and in Brussels, which are also important in crafting some of these reactions. Now, when it comes to the public outside Europe, you also asked me about the post-Soviet space. Yes, in my travels, about 5 months, four are of which were in Russia or the post-Soviet space. Yes, it's a horribly contaminated public space. Just 2 weeks ago, had a long conversation in a train with a young Kazakh student, sophisticated student, good English speaker, and he was asking me a number of questions, and he was revealing about the way he looks at the world. One of them was the terrorist attack in Paris didn't happen, did it? It's all politics. It's also interesting, this expression, that it's all politics. Politics is the realm of the absolute lie and manipulation. So when he says it's all politics, he means everything we hear is a lie. And so there was no terrorist attack. It was created by France in order to be able to do something. And you hear this sort of conspirational approach to politics all over the post-Soviet space. Is this a product of Russian propaganda to a considerable extent? To a considerable extent, it's the product of a public space that is not open, that is not competitive, where there are no freedom of expression. But certainly Russian propaganda is able to take advantage of this, very successful to take advantage in places like Kazakhstan, in places like Moldova. I think the distinction here is places where people are predominantly Russian speakers in northern Kazakhstan, in Moldova. There they are extremely vulnerable to a certain Russian way of looking at the world. But let me finish with another skeptical note. I think we have to, in some respects, the propaganda is incredibly effective. In other respects, I don't think it's effective at all, and we have to make these distinctions. Another case, again, content, where I don't think it's effective. I do sometimes read that the Kremlin has been able to propagate a number of views, let us say, for example, about Ukraine, that Ukraine was never an independent state, that it is part of Russia, that nothing distinguishes it particularly from Russia, that the two nations are sister nations, should perhaps be part of the same state. I mean, this was not created by the Kremlin over the past 2 years. These are deeply rooted ideas going back centuries, perhaps 2 centuries at least. They've always followed Ukrainian nationalism as a reaction against it. Just recently, I was reading Solzhenitsyn on Ukraine. He says exactly these things. So actually, the influence may be the other way around. It's people like Solzhenitsyn that influenced the Kremlin. I think this is very clear that it had an impact, especially on their Ukraine policy and older ideas that are subscribed by a Russian population in general, and not the Kremlin that has created, manufactured these ideas among the Russian population. When I was talking to someone in Russia about Ukraine, and she explained to me that Ukraine is a sister nation that should always be close to Russia, that if it tries to be close to the European Union, it will always be discriminated by the European Union, that it has nothing to give the European Union and a lot to give Russia. These ideas are very powerful, but not because the Kremlin manufactured them. They have been powerful for a long time among Russians, and I think to some extent the Kremlin has to subscribe to these ideas because they are what defines Russian-Ukrainian relations from the point of view of the Russian public. On this, I think we have to be skeptical about the powers of incantation that the Kremlin has, because in some respects they are limited. I'll finish with that skeptical note.
Thank you very much indeed for these insightful remarks. To briefly summarize this first round of questions, I would say that we, of course, such a panel cannot solve the problem of Russian propaganda in half an hour, but we maybe came to the conclusion that the effectiveness is more when it comes to emotions, certain sentiments, rather than facts and content, as Bruno said. However, from our panel, I think we can already see certain geographic differences with the more maybe effectiveness in France, and Bruno saying that less effectiveness in countries like Portugal. Me coming from Poland, I can confirm that as well. I would like us to move on to our second topic, that is, what can the West do? Another question that some of you might think there is no answer to in such a short format. But again, trying to elaborate or make a reference to this 1989 experience here in Poland and our attraction to Western values that I remember so well. I also would like to make a comment that it seems to me that the 20th century was still the age, the century that we were fighting for freedom of information. And today we're in 21st century, 16 years, it's 2016, and it seems to me that in the West we are still in this mode of fighting for freedom of information, which my question is, does it make us blind to the abuses of this freedom? And if this is the case, if this is what we are blind to and what's happening, and maybe yes, we have learned to distinguish facts from propaganda, but we are not able to understand or recognize certain emotions that this propaganda can create in us and that are counteractive, they act against us. So what can we as Western societies do in this regard? And I will start with Marcel again.
Yeah, thank you. I have seven proposals to fight the Russian information war. The first is spend more money. The Russians spend a lot of money. They spend about $1 billion a year. And at the same time, we have seen that after 1990 and the peace dividend and everything was well in Europe and in the world, Western governments started to decrease their budgets for public diplomacy. And public diplomacy, of course, are state budgets for states' information. And Hillary Clinton herself, she has complained about the sharp decrease in the United States for public diplomacy. I think that's one thing. The second thing is that it is a proposal by your former foreign minister, Sikorsky. Why not, should not we, Europeans and Americans, create a Russian language TV that can compete with RT? The Dutch government has given $500,000 euros after the downing of the MH17 above Ukraine at the Endowment for Democracy, the European Endowment for Democracy, to do research on this matter. And well, they have some made some initiatives, but at the moment we still not have an EU-wide Russian language TV. Latvia has taken an initiative, and last week, that is what Reitschuster, a German journalist, gave the information that there is a private initiative in Berlin with a web television at the moment. But here, I think, could be done more. The third thing is to analyze the facts, because many facts given by RT and Sputnik and so on are disinformation. And disinformation, it's not misinformation. Misinformation are pure lies. Disinformation are half truths, half lies, or even whole truth, but put in a very different context. And there have been made some initiatives. There is the EU is now editing every week a disinformation digest You can take, you can see it on the internet. And there is in Kiev, in Ukraine, an organization at the University, Mihaila University, that has started stopfake.org, and it's now, I think, about in 8 languages, even Dutch, after the referendum, and they are debunking, Russian propaganda. Spend more money, analyze the facts, create alternative Russian language TV, and I think especially in those countries with Russian minorities, and also inside Germany there are 1 million Russian speakers of old people who came out of Russia in the 1980s also. The fourth point is raise public awareness. We should, well, as you know, forewarned is forearmed. If you know that there is a possibility that there is a propaganda effort made on you, you can raise the public awareness in public, in education, in schools. And for instance, in Germany, you have the an organization for political building, for political education, that there's a lot of efforts in this sense. The fifth thing, I think it's the most important, tell the truth. We should not counter propaganda with counter propaganda, our propaganda. We should always tell the truth, and we should also tell the truth about our own mistakes and about our, we should be independent and objective. Especially we should also expose ugly sides of the West, as we did with Guantanamo or the Abu Ghraib jail. Lenin has said, a lie told often enough becomes a truth. And that's the system how works RT. Roosevelt, the American president, has said, repetition does not transform a lie into a truth. And I think that should be the Western point of view. The sixth point, I think, is important. Don't be too tolerant. And I think the Russia is very well using all the possibilities of the liberal Western system, and at the same time closing all the possibilities for the West in Russia. If you look, RT 700 million viewers worldwide, in September 14, there was a law made in Russia that forbade Western investors to have more than 20% in Russian media. And this was against Vyedomosti, that is the ownership is of 3 Western firms. Also against Forbes Russia, which is owned by Springer. So we see that Russia is trying to but the only small presence of Western media in Russia to diminish it and to throw it out. So we should ask for reciprocity, I think. And what is very important is also that, for instance, in the UK, you have an Office of Communication. And that is some kind of a watchdog. This watchdog is looking at TV, if the TV is accurate and is impartial. And this Ofcom, this watchdog in the UK, has several times given penalties to RT, especially about documentaries about Syria, and after the Crimea, the annexation of Crimea. Another point is fight trolls. And I think if you look, I had a very interesting experience. I had an interview with a Dutch paper in August 2014. That was 2 weeks after, 3 weeks after the downing of the MH17, in which most of the people were Dutch who died. It was a national disaster. And after this interview, there was a whole wave of comments sent to the website of this paper, and about 80% was pro-Putin. and asking who was paying me, who was paying the paper, etc., etc. And the editors were obliged to make a special declaration about this event. We saw the same also that the Moscow Times had to close down its comment pages because of the trolls. And even the Guardian in the UK had the same experience. They had to close down their thing. And I think we should make blacklists of trolls, publish these blacklists, and there should be set up an EU-wide agency of trolls. Of course, these trolls will go on and create different identities, but anyway, we should be behind them and follow them and see that we can fight them. So, we have a problem because we are a liberal Western society. We want to keep our liberal Western society. Russia is not a liberal Western society, and we are in an uneven position in defending our society against Russian propaganda. But anyway, we should try.
Anton, you made a reference to Andrew Wilson's echo chambers. I also want to mention his nudge propaganda theory, when he said that for Russia it's not necessary to even create these groups in the West, they exist, it's just enough that it pushes it a little bit. So in this, taking this theory into account, how can we counteract that? How can we deal with, if this is the case?
Well, I think that when we're talking about how whether Russian propaganda is efficient or successful, I'm asking myself a question whether Soviet propaganda was efficient in the West, and I think it wasn't. Despite billions of rubles spent on the so-called aktivnye meroприятия, or active measures that were controlled by the KGB and that were directed at changing the public opinion in the West, I don't think that Soviet propaganda was especially successful there, and in the end it was the Soviet Union that collapsed rather than NATO or the European Economic Union. So I believe that if we're asking questions of how to counter Russian propaganda, this means that the Western societies became weak and corrupted by the processes that are characteristic of the European society. So I always imagine that if there are some problems, the far right or the far left or those conspiracy theorists, if this is a wound on the European body or on the Western body, Russia has not created that wound, but it's pouring salt onto that wound. But still, if you want to get rid of that pain, you have to heal the wound. And this is for Europe, this is for the West to do. So I think if the European Union, if the West, especially the European Union, just starts acting towards according to its own textbook, not allowing corruption, being transparent, and just not somehow create an atmosphere where a second Gerhard Schröder is not possible, who would be, basically lobbying for the Russian interests. If the West becomes stronger again, it will not have a problem with Russian propaganda. It's not the Russian propaganda that is, successful or strong. It's the Western societies that become weaker.
And Bruno, to you as a former Secretary for European Affairs, what is your take on those institutional arrangements, such as the proposal, as Marcel mentioned, Russian language TV or anti-propaganda centers that are created in the Baltic states? Do you believe these tools, these measures are effective or not?
I don't think they hurt. I'm not maybe as optimistic as Marcel is. The European Union had this initiative to develop a center unit to debunk Russian propaganda. It's working. I think it's made up of about six people. Every 3 months they publish a report. It's online. This was discussed in a meeting I was present. I didn't defend it. I didn't criticize it. I thought it would be pretty much useless, but it wouldn't hurt. Lots of people were enthusiastic. In general, it was the ministers that were softer on Russia that were enthusiastic, perhaps thinking that the whole issue can be solved with the internet documents. So I'm a bit skeptical. I would make three suggestions. First, a suggestion to our law enforcement agencies. Yeah, they have to be very tough, uncompromising on criminal activities of different kinds. So some of you may have read Luke Harding's book on his experiences in Russia. This is not sort of soft power. This is criminal activity, state-sanctioned criminal activity, intimidating, persecuting his family, threatening his children in more or less direct ways. This was a Western, British reporter in Russia. We cannot tolerate this sort of things. I think the British government at the time was tough. We have to be tough, perhaps even tougher than they were on things like this and other cases of criminal activity. But it's criminal activity aimed at shaping opinion. Well, first of all, before everything else, it's criminal activity cannot be tolerated, right? Second, aimed at our, not law enforcement, but at our foreign ministries and others involved in public diplomacy, promote a better media environment in other countries. Don't promote specific messages. Promote a healthy media environment. In our eastern neighborhood, don't try to promote specific messages. This is not going to work. It's going to be counterproductive if you give money to people that are promoting specific messages. On gay rights, for example, on Russia, and other kinds of messages. I think it's much better to try to promote diversity, to subsidize independent small media, but not try to promote specific messages. This is perhaps another area of public policy where you can do that, but when you're trying to promote free media in places like Moldova or in places like Kazakhstan, if you try to promote specific messages, then you come across as being cultural imperialists, and this is going to be used by the other side to portray you in a certain light, so it might be counterproductive. And third, suggestion not to government but to media. It's a suggestion that's been made by other people. I think Michael Weiss has made this. I think media have to become more sophisticated. They're involved in politics. They're not neutral objective. So why not create a position of a counter-disinformation editor, someone that is politically savvy? Newspapers and other media and TVs need someone like this, someone that can alert other editors to those occasions when they are being manipulated. Can be there at the editorial meetings and say, look, in this case, we're being manipulated by a foreign government. I don't think newspapers right now have the kind of people that can do this. They are newspaper people. They're not prepared and trained to recognize this. This sort of editor would, first of all, be present in the editorial meetings and alert to specific cases of manipulation by foreign governments and others. In other cases, he would communicate to the public and explain a certain message. He would, for example, explain, we will stop replicating opinions coming from this particular foreign government because we don't think they are playing fair. We've done it for a few months. We're not going to keep on repeating this nonsense that we keep hearing. So in our news stories, opinions on Ukraine coming from the Russian foreign government are no longer going to be included. You can perhaps find it in other newspapers. We have made it this editorial choice. Right now, newspapers are not prepared to do this because their editors, again, are newspaper people that will subscribe to notions of journalistic objectivity. Well, my point is, if you don't have people to do work on political manipulation and disinformation, you are going to be manipulated. And so you can pick whether you want to have only newspaper people working there in the editorial meetings or whether you want to have other kinds of people, perhaps coming from politics or coming from intelligence services. Why not? I mean, if I was in charge of a newspaper, I want to have people like that in the editorial meetings to ensure that I'm not being manipulated by foreign governments. I think it's part of the journalistic mission not to be manipulated.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Very provocative. I'm already thinking about the recruitment process. But okay, we have about 10 to 15 minutes for to open the floor to discussion and questions. I encourage you all to take the opportunity of this wonderful panel. And okay, I see already Igor with the first questions, but please do not be shy. Ask questions, present your point of view if you disagree with the statements that were made here. And please tell us to whom the question is, okay?
Thank you very much. My name is Igor Lyubashenko. I'm from University of Social Sciences and Humanities here in Warsaw. I also cooperate with New Eastern Europe. I will probably say some more comments than questions. First of all, I would like to underline that I'm not researching this exact topic, so it is more like an amateur point of view on this particular subject right now. But first of all, I would like to underline one more effect of propaganda, or rather our speaking of Russian propaganda, which is obviously very, very clearly visible in countries like Ukraine, is when the government uses such an argument that against any critic that is targeted at the government, that you are working in the interest of Russian propaganda. Sometimes it is also seen here in Poland. And maybe a kind of question, I do not follow that closely Western press, so maybe do you see such effects further in the West? And a couple of more comments. I'm also quite skeptical about public diplomacy and maybe Russian speaking in television as a countermeasure for propaganda. Many arguments have been spoken, but this is exactly if we would have to build such kind of medium, it would have to be based on pluralism, but not on some mastermind that tells us what to tell to those societies. This will not work. It doesn't mean that such kind of medium is not needed, but it will work. It will have a different effect and rather countermeasure for propaganda, I think. And also one idea that came to me in the very end is that actually when Mr. Shekhovtsov told us to think about effectiveness of Soviet propaganda, that it was not effective, I thought that media space was completely different in that time. And now what we have is very many different channels. And what I see here, at least in Poland, and we see it in the data that we gather, is that people lack of some critical thinking recently. I mean, if you look at it doesn't refer directly to the issue of propaganda, but here in Poland we see such things that electors of party A do not believe in some facts that are convenient for party B and vice versa. And the same is with Russian propaganda, I guess. But the problem, the basic problem is that we lack critical thinking. We as the societies, Western societies. So probably you could comment on that as well. But this is not directed to anybody, but to many of them.
Good afternoon. My name is Bartosz Szydliński. I'm working at the Aleksander Kwaśniewski Foundation. I have a very short question to Anton, because you mentioned a few things about the liberal shift in Central in Western Europe. I would like to ask you about your opinion about Trump's role and his illiberal tendencies in the discussion between the US and Russia, because as Trump said, and I quote, "I hate Obama, Putin hates Obama, we have a lot of in common." So I'm wondering how you find the Trump's narrative in what you said before.
Right here, and we'll take one more question, and then we'll answer that.
Let me get back. Let me get back to the one of you who mentioned Magnitsky.
Can you hear me?
I'd like to get back to the one of you who mentioned Magnitsky, to understand where propaganda, what propaganda is. Well, we want to understand the world and the influences that are exerted on us, not from the perspective of journalists, but from the perspective of the real world. And how we understand the world and what message we give to the world, this is important. And you mentioned Magnitsky. Yeah, he was killed in custody, but he was not a lawyer, he was an accountant. He dealt with the purchase of Gazprom shares. And there was a claim. There is a claim in an American court, according to the American law, to assess the actions taken by Bowden, and this information is not revealed in Poland. We need to open Sputnik, we need to open Russia Today to get to know about these things. Another thing. I opened Sputnik just a moment before. You said that there's nuclear propaganda, and it turns out that three bombers are flying from the US today. They are going to have some exercises over the Baltic Sea, just next to our borders. Why don't we get this kind of information? Why do I have to open Sputnik to see this kind of things? You tell us things about Ukraine. You tell us that in Russia people think that the nations of Ukrainians and Russians have very tight bonds. But the Russian propaganda tells us that the situation in Ukraine is very complex, that there are different zones in Ukraine, the anti-Russian zone, there is the middle Ukraine, which is looking for some balance, which is trying to strike some balance, and there is this pro-Western Ukraine. And if you hold a referendum, the outcome of the referendum will depend on where it takes place, and we don't get information on this. And the last example from yesterday, on the Polish television, we got to know about Navalny and computers, but we don't know exactly what happened and why this happened. We have to enter Russia Today. We have to open Sputnik to learn about it, to get more details. And this is also kind of propaganda in the Polish media, because we don't get this kind of information.
Pani była przydatna. To może to dwie obie panie i
musimy. Ja bardzo krótko. A very brief comment.
European Parliament with the draftsman of the opinion to countering anti-EU propaganda. And my question is, we very often talk, or the EU talks, and not only European Parliament, that we do not want to counter propaganda with anti-propaganda. But at the same time, a lot of European politicians talk about the need to promote EU positive narratives. And I was thinking, what is your view? And that would be the question to all panelists. Is that not, in fact, propaganda? And also, to what extent can we talk about the marketing your Western values, let's say, because I find this concept a little bit problematic.
Thank you. Marta Jagusztyn, I do development programs and I've done a lot of work in China. So, and my first, I have two questions, short ones. One is, how do we actually measure how effective the propaganda is? Because you've been talking about it being effective and non-effective, ineffective. And if we are to fight it then or counteract it, we should know whether it works or not. The second question is, from your experience, I don't know how much you have looked into how effective China is at projecting its soft power, but there's lots of analogies. You've mentioned Kongzi Institutes, the Confucius Institutes. There's obviously differences, the economic power, and also some really funny attempts to sort of use Chinese-style propaganda in the West. But if you have any experience, I would be really interested in learning, have you compared the two, Russia and China, and what do you think, how do they compare?
Okay, so maybe to help my panelists, the first question or comment was about the lack of critical thinking or the problems with critical thinking in the West. Yes, anybody would like to comment on this specifically?
I missed the part of the Polish question.
Yes, I'll be translating them one by one.
Yeah. Well, there was the first questions were about if you here or in Ukraine you criticize the government, they say telling you, well, you're playing the cards of the Russian propaganda. Yeah, that's what you said. Well, I'm saying in France, everybody is criticizing the government and nobody's telling you that you are helping Russian propaganda, nor in the Netherlands. So that doesn't play a role in Western Europe. The other question was, well, that's an anti-TV or in Russian language TV, the question is it effective, yes or no? Well, I think it could not hurt to have more choice for Russian speakers in the EU. To have more choice of Russian TV, let's say that could be interesting, but it should not be state TV. It should be really an open TV, so a private TV. I think that the British solution to have a watchdog would it comes close to also. Well, Bruno said about you should be more strict with criminal practices, but also with, well, practices in the media that are not conform the media laws and should be more strictly adhered to, I think so, and not only in the UK, but Europe-wide. The question about China is that, in fact, it's very interesting. China is at the moment is copying Russian practices of Russia beyond the headlines. That means I saw the small papers that are added to. To Western papers paid for by the Chinese government, so they are copying this, like Russia is copying these Confucius Institutes. So they are both working in the same direction, in fact, and I think we can expect after the Russian propaganda offensive also a Chinese propaganda offensive. And so I think so this propaganda remains for us a problem to solve, how to solve this question and how to manage.
Yes, the issue of the paid supplements to Western press, yes, it's a big issue, not only Russia and China, but I think Polish government has been purchasing them as well, right? But the two questions to Anton, one about Donald Trump and another one about that we lack information about Russia in mainstream press, and for that reason, the gentleman stated we oftentimes need to go to Sputnik or RT to get the facts that are not present in the mainstream press.
Well, I will go back to these questions, but something that I wanted to mention about the regional TV channels, that was the case of Crimea, where they had if we were talking about the quality TV, that was only coming from Russia. So there was no Russian language TV channel from Ukraine. So it was just absent. The another TV channel was the Russian service of Euronews, but that's only a news service. It's not a quality TV channel. So and I know for sure, like 100%, that many people who were kind of loyal towards Ukraine before Russia started its disinformation campaign against Ukraine on the Russian TV channels that were transmitted to Crimea. So there were more people loyal to Ukraine than after a year of, you know, information bombardment of the Crimean citizens, or Ukrainian citizens in Crimea. Then something about Trump. Trump is a very strange case. On the one hand, he very much European in a sense of being very close to people like Viktor Orban or even Marine Le Pen. So it's a kind of a, you know, Europeanization of American politics in a sense. But at the same time, we cannot actually say that he's serious all the time. He's playing. He's a kind of a showman. We cannot say whether he is serious about being, or whether he's serious when he says that he would be good friends with Mr. Putin, because recently, for example, he said that he would shoot down all those Russian jets flying around and around our own ships and endangering our troops. So. Was that really a pro-Russian statement or pro-Putin statement? I don't think so. I don't think that Trump, at least on the issues related to Russia, we cannot judge him right now. We simply don't know whether he's serious or not serious, because sometimes he says things just, you know, mobilize the public opinion or to be controversial. That's also one of the forms of mobilization during the presidential elections. So, yeah, he looks like he's very close to European politicians such as Le Pen and Orban, but I don't know. Whether we need to go to Sputnik or RT to get some information, no, we don't have to, because some of the information that you were worrying about, it's in the information space. If you're inclined to go to Sputnik, of course you will go there. But I don't think that any facts are being hidden by the mainstream media. Sometimes on Sputnik and on RT, you would read something that is completely out of the reality. Only this fact that they don't present anything that is real would, for me, be just a countermeasure of going there. I would not read the media resource, which is just simply not true. It's not presenting facts right. If your country was accused of being a nest of fascists, would you believe that? I was living in Ukraine, and RT and Sputnik was talking about the Nazi coup in my own country. This is ridiculous, you know. I would be, you know, I will not be reading that kind of media. This is not media. This is propaganda resources and disinformatia campaigns.
Thank you very much. Bruno, would you like to add something to...
I think I'd like to answer
this
very interesting question from this member of the EU unit to fight Russian disinformation. So why do we complain about Russian propaganda when, in fact, we have our own kinds of propaganda? Maybe the word is different, but words are not that important. I think it's a really important question. I don't think anything we said here is particularly vulnerable to that criticism. I'll speak in my own name. You know, I don't want Russia to be engaged in criminal activities, to manipulate journalists, to intimidate journalists. If they violate the law, then they're not acceptable. I think this is easy to understand. I don't want us to be manipulated. either emotionally or factually, because that will lead to bad decisions. I also think this is uncontroversial. I think it's better for our neighborhood policy to promote a healthy, diverse, pluralistic media environment in other countries, because a pluralistic media environment is better than a uniform, controlled media environment. And that's about the three things I suggested. So I don't think they're particularly vulnerable to the criticism of being hypocritical or contradictory. Just some basic common sense, I think. But it's a good question. I don't think we should ask that Russia give up all its propaganda attempts. I mean, if this is what some of us are saying, we shouldn't say it. It doesn't make any sense. This is not the point. And in fact, I'm a lot more focused on the first element of a number of criminal activities that are being developed. And also, I think we need to make some changes to make our own policies and responses more sophisticated. Now, Sputnik, yeah, I just opened Sputnik to see the piece of news about the B-52 bombers. I mean, nothing against using Sputnik and RT. I sometimes read them, not very often, I sometimes read them. This piece of news does not seem very interesting to me. US B-52 bombers had for the UK for NATO military exercises. I mean, it is not even news, I would say, unless you're very interested in NATO military exercises. But sometimes there may be something interesting. I mean, no one here has said that you should not read Sputnik or RT. I mean, read as we should all read everything. It's my suggestion. Maybe a good way to finish.
Sure. And speaking about reading, of course, we, as I mentioned in the beginning, these were topics and questions that were impossible to answer in the short 1.5-hour panel. So I encourage you to continue reading about these important topics. Marcel's books, Bruno's forthcoming book, Anton's journal and writing. So please do not just finish the reflection on this panel. All three gentlemen are active on Twitter. And of course, I don't need to encourage you to read New Eastern Europe as well. We focus on that issue as well. Thank you very much to everybody. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you once again. Thank you.